गुड इवनिंग एवरीवन.
पूनम प्लीज गो अहेड. आई थिंक देवेश इज आल्सो रेडी राइट.
यस सर ही इज हियर. सो अ वेरी गुड इवनिंग टू एवरीवन. आई डॉक्टर पूनम जोशी एसोसिएट प्रोफेसर वेलकम यू ऑल ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ हेड नेक सर्जिकल ऑन्कोलॉजी टाटा मेमोरियल हॉस्पिटल इन द फर्स्ट पोस्ट ग्रेजुएट ट्रेनिंग प्रोग्राम 2021. दिस प्रोग्राम intends to impart quality education and training to the exam going residents and students of head and neck oncology, surgical oncology, ENT, maxillofacial surgery and general surgery. With the help and guidance of eminent faculty across the nation. So I welcome you all once again in our program. So I would like to invite Dr. Devendra Chokar, who is our professor and head department of head and neck surgical oncology Tata Memorial Hospital Mumbai, to give the opening remarks.
Hi Poonam, thank you for that. And can you all hear me? Poonam, am I audible?
Yes, sir. You are audible.
So, good evening, everyone, and welcome to this first part of the series of postgraduate teaching program that we've put together. When Sudhir and Poonam spoke to me about this webinar, I was not sure whether we should have one more webinar. You know, there are numerous webinars that are going on in this pandemic. But they said that we will have a webinar which is, we'll have a postgraduate teaching program, some prelims that we have before our exams. So this is targeted towards students who are giving their exams or will be giving their exams in the future. We have national faculty from across the country who are going to grill these students. You know, over the years as an examiner, I've realized that majority of the students do well in their theory. They know a lot of theory. But when it comes to practicals and viva, they are not, they cannot defend the answers that they're giving. They give answers according to what they've heard in their about the practice in their own institutions. But there's always a gray area in head and neck, and no one answer is right or wrong. So it's important, whatever answer you give, you must back it with literature, with sound reasoning, more practical reasoning in practicals. In theory, you can write a whole bunch of reasons for a particular disease process. But in practicals, you have to manage the patient who's there in front of you. And therefore, you need to back it up with sound reasoning. And that's the intention of this postgraduate teaching program. National faculty from across India will ask questions and try and guide these students to answer correctly in their exams. So I welcome all the national faculty and I thank them for taking time off on a Saturday evening and helping us out with this postgraduate teaching program. And a special thank you to Sudhir and Poonam who have put it together, and all my colleagues at Tata Hospital who will be participating in this program. So before, I'll not take much time. So welcome to all of you again. Back to Poonam to get our first case started and introduce our panel for the first case.
So, thank you, sir. So, as we move on forward, I would like to request our delegates to post questions on the chat box of Zoom platform and the YouTube live link which is being provided to them. So, our first case of the today's evening is a case presentation on carcinoma buccal mucosa and gingival buccal complex. So I would like to invite the faculty members, the expert panelists for the same. So I would like to invite Dr. Devendra Chokar, professor and head department of head and neck surgical oncology, Tata Memorial Hospital. I would like to invite Dr. Deepak Sareen, Director, Head and Neck Surgical Oncology, Medanta, Medicity, Gurugram. Dr. Vikram Kekatpure, Senior Consultant and Director, Head and Neck Surgical Oncology, Site Care Cancer Hospital, Bangalore. Today's moderator of the first session is Dr. Sudhir Nair, Professor, Head and Neck Surgical Oncology and Officer in Charge, Surgical Oncology at ACTRAC, Tata Memorial Center, Mumbai. So I welcome you all once again, sir, And over to you, Dr. Sudeep.
Thank you, Poonam. I think we will not waste much on further introductions. I think I'll invite Dr. Devesh. Devesh Bellal is a second year surgical oncology registrar, and he will be presenting on carcinoma of buccal mucosa. Devesh, please go ahead.
Good evening, respected sirs. I'm Dr. Devesh, and I'll be starting the case presentation with the case of a carcinoma of gingival buccal sulcus. A 48-year-old housewife who resides in Navi Mumbai presented to our OPD with the chief complaints of an ulcer in the buccal mucosa since the past 3 months. She says that she had an ulcer in the right buccal mucosa since the past 3 months, which gradually increased in size from the initial size of 1 into 1 centimeters to the current size of 4 into 3 centimeters. The ulcer is associated with pain, which is localized to the oral cavity, which aggravates on eating spicy food and reduces on taking analgesics. The ulcer is also accompanied with foul-smelling discharge and excessive salivation over the past 2 months. The patient also complains of loosening of right lower teeth, for which she has had multiple teeth removed over the past 3 months. The patient also gives history of a swelling in the right side of the neck since the past 1 month, which was insidious at onset, not associated with any pain, and has stayed fairly constant in size of around 2 centimeters. There is no history of reduced mouth opening. There is no history of pain radiating to the ear. There is no history of any change in voice or difficulty in swallowing. There is no history of any sharp teeth or ill-fitting dentures. The patient doesn't give any history of cough, hemoptysis, or any bone pain. The patient is a mushroom user for the past 20 years, using it about 2 to 3 times a day. She has no other addictions present. She is nil premorbid and has no prior treatment history. There is no family history of any malignancy. In summary, this is the history of a 48-year-old lady who is nil premorbid, whose only addiction is mushroom use over the past 20 years, with an ulcerative lesion in the right gingival buccal sulcus over the past 3 months, which has progressively increased in size. There is history of loosening of teeth, and there is history which suggests cervical lymphadenopathy. Moving on, general examination. After obtaining informed consent, the patient was examined in a well-lit room. She is a middle-aged lady who is well-oriented to time, place and person. She is moderately nourished and built with a BMI of 22 kg per meter square. She has a good performance status with an ECOG score of 1. There is no pallor, icterus, cyanosis, generalized lymphadenopathy or pedal edema present. Moving on to the local examination of the oral cavity, there is a swelling over the cheek at the level of the right ramus and body of the mandible. Mouth opening is adequate, permitting 3 fingers inside. The oral hygiene is poor and there are multiple carious teeth present. The patient is partially edentulous. All the teeth except the right lower premolar are missing. There is an ulceroproliferative lesion with everted edges over the right lower GBS involving the lower alveolus, which measures 5 into 3 centimeters. The extent of the lesion is anteriorly 1.5 centimeters posterior to the commissure at 3 centimeters to the right of the left central incisor. Posteriorly, the lesion reaches the right RMT. Medially, it involves the alveolus but is 0.4 centimeters away from the gingival lymphoid sulcus and the floor of the mouth is free. The skin is close but uninvolved. The lower GBS is involved but upper GBS is free. There is gross paramandibular disease present. There is another 2 into 1 centimeter ulceroproliferative lesion in the upper GBS away from the first lesion, which is at the level of the upper second molar, 1.5 centimeters away from the index lesion. Anteriorly, this lesion extends up until the second molar, posteriorly up until the last upper right molar. Medially, it involves the upper alveolus but does not encroach upon the hard palate. The tongue shows no signs of wasting, no fasciculations or deviation on movement. On palpation, there is no tenderness or local rise of temperature. The inspectory findings regarding the dimensions of the lesion are confirmed. However, there is induration which is palpable 5 millimeters away from the visible extent of the disease in all directions. there is gross paramandibular disease extending from the right RMT till 1 centimeter proximal to the commissure. The digitolingual sulcus and floor of the mouth are free. The skin is close but free. Also, there is sensation over the chin. Moving on to the examination of the neck, there is a single 2 by 2 centimeter right level 1B node, which is hard. It is fixed to the mandible, but the overlying skin is free. There is another 1 into 1 centimeter right level 2 lymph node, which is hard but mobile, with the overlying skin being normal. The thyroid is not palpable, and a Hopkins examination was not done. Systemic examination, a respiratory system, there were normal vesicular breath sounds heard bilaterally. Air entry is bilaterally equal. In summary, a 48-year-old lady who was nil premorbid with a good performance score, who is a machete user for the past 20 years, who presented with an ulceroproliferative growth in the right GBS involving the RMT with a second lesion involving the upper GBS. There is a fixed ipsilateral 1B node and another ipsilateral level 2 node. There is good mouth opening.
I think
you begin. In your history, you said there is no referred pain to the ear. Do you expect referred pain from the buccal mucosa? And which are the sites that you get referred pain to the ear in oral cavity?
So the buccal mucosa, the tongue, because of because the lingual branch of the trigeminal nerve can refer pain, because the trigeminal nerve also gives the auricular temporal branch to the ear. So there can be referred pain along that pathway through the tongue. The trigeminal buccal branches also supply parts of the buccal mucosa, so there can be referred pain to the ear even from other sites in the buccal mucosa, sir.
Which nerve in the buccal mucosa needs to be involved for referred pain to the ear? Anyway, inferior alveolar can have with the auricular temporal can have referred pain to the ear, Devesh.
Yes.
I don't know whether I missed it, but in your history, did you in your examination, did you anybody else, Vikram, Deepak on history? Do you want to ask him anything? Please go ahead.
Yeah, no, it's just a comment. A history is good. I would suggest when you get your history, also try to get status about the patient's nutritional intake and whether they've had any weight loss, because these can be important parameters in deciding how to treat going forward. You mentioned the thyroid not palpable specifically while examining the neck. Any reason why you specifically mentioned that?
No, sir. No relation with the primary lesion, just on examination of the neck for the sake of completion.
Devesh, I just have a question about the loose teeth you mentioned and a serial extraction. So, how do you make out that these extractions were not related to disease or they are related to disease?
So, the time frame of the extractions is one feature. So, the extractions all happened after the ulcer was noticed. Secondly, there's a rapid fall of only the right lower teeth. It's not generalized to the entire oral cavity. The upper teeth have been no extractions. So it's probably disease related only, sir.
I may have missed, but you said there is a distance between the gingivobuccal sulcus and the alveolus. Is that right?
No, sir. There's two diseases, two lesions, sir. So there is a distance between the two diseases. They're separated by 1.5 centimeters.
Okay.
So another thing that helps you, Devesh, when you want to judge extraction is often teeth in the presence of the cancer will be extracted and whether there was relief in symptoms or not. So patients may go to a dentist saying, I have pain in the teeth, and they get extracted thinking it's dental pain. But relief in pain will tell you whether it was a true, correct dental extraction or a missed extraction for actually a cancer that flows by.
Yes.
So you didn't mention anything about submucous fibrosis. We can talk a little bit about that. Did this patient have submucous fibrosis?
No, sir. On palpation, there were no vertical bands palpable. There is no trismus. She has no burning sensation in the mouth and eating spicy food. And the mucosa is supple. There's no signs of submucous fibrosis in this lady, sir.
So what can you define for us what is SMF, oral submucous fibrosis?
Submucous fibrosis is a condition in which the lamina propria and submucosa is replaced with hyaline and fibrous tissue. There are vertical bands of fibrosis which occur throughout the buccal mucosa. It's a disease which is predominantly found in Southeast Asia due to the habit of betel nut chewing. So eventually the fibrosis of the subepithelial tissue leads to epithelial atrophy, which makes it a precancerous condition and increases the likelihood of cancer forming. So initially it will start with just symptoms of burning sensation in the mouth with blanching of the mucosa. As it progresses, there will be visible and palpable fibrous bands vertically oriented, which cause trismus and eventually dysphagia. It also leads to a very pathognomic facies called the submucous fibrosis or the Gupta facies in the terminal stages.
And what other than areca nut? I mean, that's the correct. So, how does areca nut cause SMF? What's the pathophysiology behind areca nut and SMF?
So, there are different theories. One is there are multiple carcinogenic irritant compounds present within the in the areca nut, which lead to
you'll have to name one at least. Any idea?
No, sir.
Okay, that's no problem. I mean, there's ericoline, that's the alkaloid most attributed to, and there are many others as well, and there are other and the pathogenesis is two ways. There are pro-fibroblastic chemicals. Ericoline is a classic example, and there are chemicals that are anti-collagenases, like the tannins. So it's a multiple factors in areca nut that eventually land up to SMF. Any other attributable causes for SMF other than areca nut? Can you get it in a non-chewer?
It is very strongly attributed to betel nut and areca nut chewing. However, it can occur in other smokeless forms of tobacco. It can occur, sir.
I am not sure if smokeless tobacco is associated. Maybe I can be corrected, but it does happen in people who've never taken tobacco or betel nut. And various theories would put it down sometimes to chilies or the capsaicin seen in chilies and a lot of zinc and micronutrient deficiencies. All theories, but it's quite rare to get it, but it does happen in somebody who's never ever used the areca nut or tobacco.
So Devesh, how do you think your patient developed this lesion? What is the carcinogenesis expected in your patient?
So she's using machete, which is a form of tobacco. So tobacco is very strongly related to oral cancer, and tobacco chewers have a 5 to 25 increased risk of developing malignancy. There are multiple promoters and initiators of carcinogenesis in tobacco. So because of the long-term tobacco use over 20 years, the entire oral mucosa would be fully cancerized, and one of those lesions would have progressed into an invasive form of malignancy. Sir.
So is there a difference between the tobacco chewing carcinogenesis and smoking carcinogenesis?
Yes, sir. Tobacco chewing is more of a local form of irritant, sir. So,
can you name any different carcinogens in chewing versus smoking tobacco?
So in smoking, it's mainly the tar and polycyclic hydrocarbon related. In the chewing form of tobacco, it's also related to the lime, the betel nut, the other irritants that are present.
No, we are talking only about tobacco, not betel nut or lime. Pure tobacco, one which is being chewed and one which is being smoked.
I'm not sure.
So one is nitrosamines, the chewing one, and other is the aryl hydrocarbon, because these are the combustion products. So they're different carcinogenic pathway. You mentioned she might have had a pre-malignant lesion there which might have transformed. Can you tell us what is the percentage of transformation of pre-malignant lesion?
So it depends on the lesion. Yes, okay. So the WHO now classifies them as potentially malignant disorders. So leukoplakia has around a 1.3% chance of annual conversion into a malignancy. This is much higher with, say, inhomogeneous leukoplakia or erythroplakia is even higher. So depending on what the lesion was, the incidence of malignancy would vary.
So higher means how much in erythroplakia?
So in erythroplakia, there is a series in which they have biopsied around 96 cases, and they found that 50% of the patients had invasive carcinoma in the erythroplakia as it was biopsied. 40% of them had CIS or high-grade dysplasia, and 9% of them had some form of dysplasia. So erythroplakia has a very, very high incidence of conversion to malignancy. The exact rate, I'm not very sure. So, but erythroplakia is, if not pre-malignant, it's almost likely to turn into a malignancy, sir. It should always be addressed.
And
Devesh,
what about the location? Does the location of the pre-malignant lesion affect the...
Yes, sir. There are certain locations which have higher risk of conversion, such as floor of the mouth or the lateral tongue. So, leukoplakia in these areas is met with a higher index of suspicion.
Yeah, a simple algorithm is as you come from outside towards the inside of the mouth, the risk of transformation of premalignant lesions goes up. Low end buccal mucosa alveolus higher in tongue and floor of mouth, as you said. This patient
Devesh, has in your history, you mentioned. Go ahead, Deepak.
No, Devendra, you go ahead, please. I'll go next.
Yeah, no, so you mentioned examination of the other oral cavity and Hopkins examination in your this, and you said there's two lesions which are 1.5 centimeter apart. So what would you say this, and what is the incidence, and why do you check the entire oral cavity? What are the incidence of second primary? What do you understand by second primary tumors?
Second primary, so the incidence of second primary is around 1% per year, which is cumulative. So as the years progress, it keeps increasing. This is based on the concept of free cancerization proposed by Slaughter, which says that the entire cancer is not an isolated cellular phenomenon. The entire mucosa is exposed to the same carcinogenic effect and is therefore condemned, where there is morphologically normal but genetically altered mucosa. And so this leads to the formation of multiple tumors in multiple areas in different sites of the oral cavity, which can occur either synchronously or metachronously.
What is metachronous?
The temporal lesion less than 6 months would consider it as a synchronous lesion. So more than 6 months would be a metachronous lesion.
All right.
Yeah. Okay. So Devesh, other than what you said, which can field cancerization, which can lead to second primaries, are there any other theories that have been used to explain second primaries?
There are some theories which state that the cancer, once it's formed through the saliva, can disseminate to other parts, which can form the second primaries elsewhere. So this is another theory.
Anything else? So there are two broad theories if you want to look at them. One is, as you said, wide field exposure of a carcinogen, and the occurrence of second primaries are independent, unrelated effects. The other is, there is a common single event where a clonal proliferation occurs of a progenitor cell. And either this genetically abnormal cell spreads and then cancers arise in this clonal proliferation of abnormal cells. Or, as you said, micrometastases in subepithelial plane from a primary tumor. But these, the latter two, are supposed to be less accepted compared to what you said as the first, which is a widespread insult by a carcinogen on a long field, because clonal studies tend to show that multiple primaries often don't have the same clonal region. So it's probably independent, unrelated effects. But there are other theories as well as to why second primaries happen. So should you screen for a second primary routinely in every case?
Yes, sir. You definitely should, sir. You should examine the entire oral mucosa. You should do a Hopkins examination. And the metastatic workup that we'll do will also screen for a second primary in the lungs, sir, if that occurs.
Okay.
So, Devesh, tell us then, what do you want to do with this patient go ahead. Tell us the clinical management of this patient now.
So I would first like, aside from the routine labs of hemogram or RFT, serum electrolytes and coagulation, I would like to get a biopsy from the edge of the lesion, a punch biopsy from the edge of the lesion to confirm my diagnosis of malignancy. After which I would like to image.
What is this edge of the lesion? What is edge of the lesion?
So generally in a malignancy.
My edge of the lesion?
So the vascularity is least at the center and cancers tend to outgrow the vascularity. So if you biopsy from the central aspect of the lesion, you may just get necrotic cells. So you tend to biopsy towards.
Devesh, a better answer would be to Devesh, a better answer, you're right, but the better answer would be to biopsy from the most representative part of the tumor.
Yes.
You don't want to biopsy a necrotic area, you want to biopsy the most representative part, okay?
Yes, sir.
Next.
After which I
like, would you biopsy both lesion or one lesion?
So I would biopsy only one lesion because the management will not change. Even if the second lesion does not come back as malignant, it is very close to primary and will be included in the resection margin. So my treatment will not change based on the biopsy of the second lesion.
I said that's a fair answer. I would have biopsied both, but you defended your point well.
Yes, sir. So after the biopsy, I'd like to image both the primary and do a metastatic workup. In this case, that would be I would like to proceed with the contrast CT with the puff cheek technique of the head and neck with the non-contrast CT of the thorax.
So, Devesh, I'm going to stop you here and ask you, assume your biopsy comes back as squamous cell carcinoma.
Yes.
And ignore the fact that you've done a CT. How would you manage this patient based on your clinical exam? When you're seeing this patient in the OPD, what are you thinking? What is likely going to be required in this patient?
So based on the examination, it is a fairly advanced lesion. There is definitely bone involvement. There is definitely a hard fixed node, which would be a N3B node. So she will require surgery, which would entail a composite resection. Because the second lesion is in the upper alveolus, it will require a composite resection of both upper alveolus and the mandible. It is close to the skin. There will be skin excision also. The neck will need to be addressed with a comprehensive neck dissection in the form of an MND. So the treatment will be primarily surgical only, sir.
And why do you say the bone is obviously involved? When would you resect the mandible in an oral cavity cancer of the alveolus or gingivobuccal sulcus?
So if there is gross bony invasion seen on imaging modality, if there are that is one thing. So if the patient is edentulous or post-RT, where a marginal mandibulectomy would not suffice, and if there is obviously any sign imaging, if there is imaging features suggestive of bony involvement, so these cases you have to do a segmental dissection of the bone. In cases which do not meet these criteria, where the tumor is just abutting the bone and the bone just needs to be removed from the margin, you can get away with a rim or a marginal mandibulectomy, sir.
What about paramandibular spread?
Yes, sir. This patient had gross paramandibular disease. That is an indication for a segmental dissection, sir.
And at what point do you think for paramandibular spread only, would you shift from a marginal to a segmental? And why?
So if there is a large amount of paramandibular disease, the treatment of choice would be a segmental. A marginal mandibulectomy would not be adequate oncologically in these patients.
And let me rephrase it. How much of the mandible do you think you need to save to be able to get away with a margin?
So you need at least 1 centimeter of vertical height of the mandible to prevent stress fractures of the remnant after the marginal. So if you can achieve this with the marginal, you should proceed, otherwise you have to do a segmental.
And compared to the anterior aspect of the mandible and the posterior, which site is more amenable to a marginal?
I'm not sure.
So the anterior is always more amenable to a marginal because the vertical height of the mandible is much higher at the arch, around 40 mm in adult males, and it's about 32, 33 mm at the back. So you are likely to be able to get an oncologic resection and still save a good lower border. Also, the lower border is strongest in the symphysis, so less likely to have stress fractures. So, of course, you can do it at both sides, but your anterior marginal lesions are more amenable to marginal. It can be done. You said radiation is a reason to do a segmental. Is that an absolute reason to do a segmental?
No, sir. It's just been found that post-radiation, there are multiple breaks in the periosteum, and this leads to multiple potential sites of mandibular invasion by the tumor. So, it would be safer to do a segmental in these cases.
Devish, my question to you is, you said gross mandibular erosion is there. The patient had a recent history of dental extraction done. How would you differentiate extraction-related bone changes versus tumor erosion?
So there is gross paramandibular disease in this patient. There's no gross.
I'm talking about the bone. I'm talking about the bone involvement.
So if there is any fracture of the mandible, that's obviously not related to dental extraction. Secondly, chronic extractions, the
fracture is a far-fetched thing. I'm talking about the superficial in the socket erosion. How would you differentiate those?
So if you have disease which is abutting that area, it could move more in favor of disease erosion which is causing it. However,
so the contiguous disease extending up to the marrow, as you said, fracture, complete bone erosion, these are in favor of disease extension. While if you have a superficial erosion, probably they might be extraction related and you might require additional investigation in those cases to rule out any marrow involvement. But you rightly said, I think the contiguous involvement with the marrow involvement would be a disease related.
Okay, Devesh, go ahead.
Devesh, just for question, when would you do a PET CT? Would you do a PET CT at all? And if yes, when? When would you do an MRI, just for completion of investigation?
So an MRI is more sensitive than CT to look at nerve involvement and marrow involvement. However, a CT will give you indirect evidence to suggest nerve involvement in the form of foramina widening. So if you are suspecting some form of nerve involvement which may change your plan, you may want to go with an MRI. An MRI will also give you better idea about the marrow involvement of the tumor. A PET CT will add, I would not like to do a PET CT over here, so because the chance of the patient developing mets outside the lung in the absence of lung mets is very low, sir. The chance of extrathoracic mets is less than 4%, and even less with isolated extrathoracic mets. So a CT, NCCT thorax would pick up most of my metastatic disease, and the cost benefit ratio would not be suitable for the PET scans. I would not like to offer a PET scan for this patient. In a recurrent patient, or a patient with multiple positive lower level nodes, where the chance of extrathoracic disease increases, I would like to proceed with the PET scan in those cases.
So for staging the neck, assuming you, just for staging the neck, how would you compare an ultrasound with a CT, with an MR, with a PET?
Sir, the meta-analysis for Leo et al. Gives all of them pretty much similar, so around 86 to 89% of sensitivity. So there is, I would prefer to image both the neck and the primary with one modality. In this case, it should be the CT. An ultrasound with an FNAC does add some sensitivity, sir, but it will not change my management plan. So routinely, I would not like to offer the ultrasound.
So I'm sorry, which meta-analysis did you quote?
Liao et al.
I see. Is that the one in the N0 next? Because I remember very different figures from that one. Is that the meta-analysis on N0-NEX?
Yes, sir.
So, see, what I remember, the sensitivity was 60 to 70% for N0, and specificity was about 80 to
90. Quoting the specificity,
sir. Yeah, oh, okay. And there was very little difference between all four, right?
Yes, sir.
Correct. I mean, okay.
So, do you have all the
information? Would it be fair to say that your imaging modality for the neck will be decided primarily by what you think you need for the primary?
Yes, sir. That would be the most cost-effective modality, sir.
Okay.
I'll just intervene on two, three audience questions also, so that we can clear that and go ahead. So one person is asking, if second primary is suspected, isn't it PET CT needed to check for metastasis in the chest or other aerogenic tract? So do we need a PET CT in case of a second primary? That's what the audience question is. Devesh, what is your answer? And
no, sir. I would not like, because the second primary, even if it exists, will be staged like a primary. The chance of a patient developing isolated extrathoracic metastasis is very low. And so a PET CT will not add much benefit, sir.
I think I agree with that. I think Vikram and Devendra,
I agree. It's a local disease. It doesn't upstage it. It doesn't add to the incidence of distant metastasis. So yes, local examination is good enough with this kind of the chest.
And then one more question, Lala, for this thing. They were asking, do we need to do biopsy first or CT first? Devesh?
So I would always like to do the biopsy first, sir, because even though in this case it's almost 99% malignant, in some lesions it may not actually be malignant. So I would like to do my imaging knowing what exactly I'm dealing with first. If that is in an ideal case, sir, I would prefer to do the biopsy first.
I agree with that.
Is there a downside to doing a biopsy before imaging, theoretically and practically?
So the biopsy will alter the imaging findings, but in this case, that doesn't really matter, sir, because it will entail a large resection, so it will not have any clinical implication.
Agreed. In this case, not, but particularly in tongue, you have to be careful. You can put up a lot of striking edema in the tongue, which an MR will pick up and overestimate often. But I agree with you. So last question before we move on. When would you order a PET CT for a patient with oral cavity cancer?
So if there is a bulky nodal disease in the level 4 or level 5, if it is a recurrent disease with already a patient has already received treatment, these cases I would, and multiple bulky nodes, lower neck, these cases I would like to get a PET CT.
Devesh, I have one question to you.
Your
imaging findings, can you state three factors about the primary which will help you and alter your treatment plan or help you to decide the treatment plan? Three findings.
So one would definitely be the ITF involvement, especially high ITF. Second would be the mandible, so whether the mandible is eroded or not.
Okay.
Yes, and then obviously the neck, if the neck,
primary. Let's
the primary. Talk about, okay, sir.
One more factor about primary.
So the if the disease is involving the inferior alveolar nerve up until the mandibular foramen, if it's extending beyond that, then you will have to resect even that part of the mandible. If there's widening of the foramen ovale, it becomes undissectable. So
unlikely though. What about skin? How do you decide about the skin, the lateral extent of the disease?
Yes, sir. So skin, if the buccinator is breached, then there is no, the skin will have to be removed, even if it is free, sir. As a margin, the skin will have to be removed. Yes, sir. So that would be an imaging finding which will tell me that skin needs to be removed. But clinically also, the disease is very close to the skin. I would like to supplement that with the imaging finding too, sir.
Okay.
We have another 5 minutes, so probably, and after that 5 minutes, we can discuss the audience questions also.
Okay, great.
Devesh, go ahead with the rest of the presentation.
What do you do for this patient?
Pardon, sir?
Management.
Yes, sir. So the CT findings, the images are here, sir. This is a coronal section, which shows the, this is the second lesion, sir. This is the first lesion with intervening normal mucosa. The second lesion is eroding the inferior and posterior lateral wall of the maxilla. There is also a video of the CT, sir. So it is predominantly a lower GBS lesion, the primary, sir. It's a predominantly lower GBS lesion. Starting here, sir. With which is this loss of fat planes.
So since Devesh, we're out of time, tell me, how will you get margins in this and how will you decide whether you need to excise skin or not? Does imaging help you for that?
Yes, sir.
If you're excising, mucosal margins are clean, it's in front of you. How do you get third dimension? How do you decide it?
So, if obviously if the skin is involved, you will have to go. So, even if the skin is not involved, if the buccinator is breached, then there is, for margin sake, you will have to remove the skin, sir.
Right. So, buccinator is kind of gives you an indication whether, so it's clinical examination and your CT finding.
Yes, sir.
Combination of that will give you. What do you understand by the CT scan tells you that there is fat stranding? What do you understand by fat stranding? Does that mean that the lymphatics are involved? How do you interpret fat stranding on CT scan? The report comes back saying it's fat stranding.
So fat stranding can be because of tumor infiltration. It can also be because of inflammation, sir. So usually in a malignant setting, it usually implies that there is the density of the fat is lost because there is something else in the fat, either in the form of tumor emboli or some inflammatory substance. So fat stranding can be because of tumor.
Yeah, it majority of the time it is because of inflammation and not tumor. So it does, fat stranding does not imply that there is lymphatic spread into the subcutaneous tissue. Great. Go ahead. So what did you do for this patient?
So, for this patient, I would like to offer a surgery. The surgery would entail a right hemimandibulectomy with a right infrastructure maxillectomy with a right comprehensive neck dissection in the form of a right MND 1 to 5 with skin excision. The reconstruction, I would like to offer the patient an osteocutaneous flap in the form of a free fibula, sir, to reconstruct the continuity of the mandible with possible dental implants at a later date if the patient is affording.
Will you decide on the reconstruction depending on the mandibular defect? Maybe Vikram can take over here for the reconstruction.
Devesh, one quick question. Is your clinical staging correct? We are talking about two primaries. Is that correct?
So there should be a M after the T4B. So it should be C T4B brackets M.
Okay, correct. Right. So how would you decide about the reconstruction?
So there are certain absolute indications for which you would need bony reconstruction. If you are any defect crossing the midline would require where the arch of the mandible is compromised would require bony reconstruction to prevent an anti-gum deformity. So that's the mandibular defect. The maxillary defect will also depends on the type of maxillary defect, where brown type up to a type 2A may not require any reconstruction other than an obturator. But anything beyond that will, especially if the orbit or the lateral wall, or medial wall is involved, will require some form of bony reconstruction.
Okay, so what will you plan for your patient though?
So I would like to offer the patient a right hemimandibulectomy with a right infrastructural maxillectomy, which would entail a skin excision and a modified radical neck dissection, 1 to 5.
So, and? And something more?
A reconstruction in the form of osteocutaneous flap or free fibula.
What about infratemporal fossa?
So this patient does not have any disease in the ITF, sir.
I thought it is just touching the medial pterygoid, lower extent. Anyway, in the interest of time,
Vikram wants to ask you is, what do you understand by compartmental resection and would you do a compartmental
resection? So this is based on a paper published by Narayana, Dr. Kuryakos, where they said that the entire ITF acts like a compartment. So any disease, any T4B disease which is involved in the ITF should be resected with the entire compartment, which involves both the pterygoids, medial and lateral pterygoid, the pterygoid plates, and the entire ITF compartment should be resected. And they've had good results with this approach, sir. So, a compartmental resection for very advanced T4B diseases is a valid treatment option, sir.
Does this patient require compartment resection?
So, from what I saw in the CT, there is no involvement of the ITF medial pterygoid to mesene free, sir. So, I would not think that this patient requires any ITF clearance, sir.
And I, so clinically, I think his mouth opening is also good.
Fair enough.
Also indicates that the muscle is not involved.
Fair enough.
Yep.
Yeah.
And is it necessary to remove half the mandible in a patient like this who has disease limited to the
body? So the disease is extending up until the where the lateral incisor would be, sir. So we would have to remove two teeth lateral to that, which would be a hemimandibulectomy, sir.
So I think I'll interfere here. Again, one more two audience questions and then we will wind off this.
Sudhir, just one last question. We've not touched upon radiation. So one last question.
Yes.
So you operated this patient and now it comes back as T2. Bone is not involved. N1, the external nodes are negative. What is your take on giving radiation for N1 disease?
So what is it, sir?
N1 disease of the neck. Will you radiate? Will you not radiate? It's a T2. Bone not involved, size is about 3.5 centimeters, no other bad features, well differentiated, but so one node positive.
So this is a bit doubtful, sir. N1 disease is sort of a gray area. If it's more than N1, it definitely requires radiation, and because it's also T2, well differentiated, no other risk features, I would still like to offer radiation, sir. But that may not be an absolute indication, sir.
You need to back your answer. This is squamous carcinoma of the buccal mucosa. It is not a HPV positive cancer. So for N1, do you have any backing to say that you don't need to radiate? What are the studies which have shown that N1 outcomes of N1 radiation in N1 disease? Are you aware of any?
I'm not sure.
Okay, so currently N1 disease radiation is performed better with disease with local control as well as overall survival in most of the series that have been reported. For oropharynx, for HP positive, they have now reported that you may omit, but still there is no concrete evidence to do that or de-escalate treatment. So for squamous carcinomas, HPV negative, clearly N1 disease to date, you need to give post-operative radiation. I think Sudhir, you can take over from here. We have a lot of other questions, but I think
I think two, three questions I'll select. One was Ankit was asking whether, you know, in the CT, mandibular canal and marrow is showing involved. Should you consider a posterior mandibulectomy, hemimandibulectomy rather than a segmental mandibulectomy? So Devesh, any comment on that?
So I didn't understand, sir. What's the question?
So suppose the marrow is involved. And the nerve is involved, you know, inferior alveolar nerve is involved in the scan. Which should we go ahead with a posterior segmental mandibulectomy or a segmental mandibulectomy or hemimandibulectomy?
So that depends on the level of at which the nerve is involved. If the nerve is involved up until the mandibular foramen, then obviously the posterior segment will have to be removed. If the nerve is involved only from the mental foramen within the mandibular canal, but the mandibular foramen per se, it is not involved at that level, then there's no indication to resect the nerve beyond the mandibular foramen.
If I can add how one would look at that is, I think if you have involvement, gross mandibular involvement or clear evidence of perineural spread on the imaging or clinically, then you should at least reject the entire nerve that runs in the mandible. Means your upper cut should be at least higher than the foramen incisura where the inferior alveolar nerve enters. And if you have available, one would want to get a frozen of the proximal cut end of the inferior alveolar nerve, because the perineural spread proximally can be a lot more than what is clinically apparent based on the tumor, and may not always be picked up on imaging, and you can get skip perineural spread also. So at least this is what we were taught, that if you see gross suspicion of PNI or marrow involvement, proximal cut above foramen incisura and include the whole nerve that runs in the mandible. I don't know if everybody else agrees with that.
Agreed.
Yeah.
You need to excise the whole thing. You need to clip the nerve and send it for frozen suspicion as well.
Yes.
One more, we should have clarity about the staging which has been reported. Now, T4B and M is missing, he said. But then we discussed that there is no infratemporal fossa involvement. So what is it? It is making T4B.
Devesh. So the masseter is involved, sir. So T4B, as per the AGCC 8, is masseteric space, which includes the masseter. So that would be what would make a T4B in this case.
So I think here Dr. Toprani is asking how much masseter you should excise.
Since we are doing such an extensive dissection, we can excise the masseter from the insertion onto the zygomatic arch, sir. Because the entire mandible with even the maxilla is being cleared, sir. And yes, sir.
Yeah, I think we routinely we don't go into the infratemporal fossa and clear all the lateral pterygoid and medial pterygoid up from the pterygoid plates. But in this case, the entire masseter, most of the masseter should be removed because tumor can spread, and this is one of the common area where recurrences can happen. So infratemporal fossa recurrence is also a common after buccal mucosa excision. That is the most common local liposuction, local cause of recurrence in a buccal mucosa cancer. Vikram can add on that if he
knows. Certainly, and when you have a RMT tumor, the base of RMT is formed by the medial pterygoid muscle, so it will come in your resection. Quickly, for interest of audience, how much would be your mucosal margins? We have not spoken about the margins.
The mucosal margin should be the final pathological thing should be more than 5 mm. So we would take a 1 cm margin surgically, taking into account that there is a shrinkage after formalin processing. So more than 5 mm, the final histopathological report is what we aim for. So mucosal margin of 1 cm is what we take surgically.
Okay, and when do you call it a close margin and when you call it as a positive margin?
So a close margin, they'd say, is less than 5 mm, and a positive margin is tumor at the margin, sir.
What if it is 1 mm? What do you call it?
Devesh, 1 mm is considered as involved margin. Okay. So I think we can wrap up this discussion, and I'll ask the examiners to rank Devesh, assess, what is your assessment? How is his performance?
Vikram, can you quickly?
I think great, it was good, but I was few things we should never make a mistake. One is about the staging and some basic issue about the buccal mucosa, about which muscle to excise, how much should be the margin, and basic concept about the positive margin, because these are decision changing facts. So in the way, if you have a positive margin, you would either re-resect or supplement it with CTRT. So staging, margin status, and all risk factor stratification is of primary importance from oncological point of view. But you did great, Devesh. All the best.
Deepak?
So I also think, Devesh, you did well. You're second year, so it's pretty good, and you'll only get better. My only suggestion in exam is, if you're asked a question, answer specifically. The wider you go, the more likely you dig a hole you'll fall into. So, and just present more and more. There's nothing like presenting again and again to different people, because you learn a little bit different from every person you do. But you did well, I think.
Devesh, overall, well done. You could defend your answers, and I think you did pretty well. Sudhir, please take over and we can move ahead.
Yes. Thank you, Devesh, and all the panelists. Thank you so much for the today. And I think we have a next interesting session. We have imaging on oral cavity cancer.